Hello dear students and welcome to another session on appreciating poetry. A very good morning to all of you. So we'll begin the next poem, and the next poem that we shall handle is Langston Hughes, Mother to Son. Langston Hughes was an African American. His real name is James Mercer Langston Hughes, and he was a poet, a social activist, a novelist, a playwright, and he is one of the early innovators of the literary art form called jazz poetry, and he is best known as a leader of the Harlem Renaissance. He famously wrote about the period that Negro was in vogue, meaning fashion, which was later paraphrased as when Harlem was in vogue. His poem, Mother to Son, is an example of Harlem Renaissance poetry. When we study this poem, we have to take into account the historical context as well. Hughes, as I told you earlier, was an important member of the Harlem Renaissance, and he wrote extensively on the oppression and racism that our black Americans faced. With this in mind, the speaker can be seen as a generalized image of an African American mother who wants to explain the troubles her black son is going to face as he ages. So before we start, let's get to know what Harlem Renaissance is. Now, Harlem Renaissance was a movement in the 1920s and 30s that involved an explosion of African American art and writing. It had a profound impact on America. Literature before this period, mostly published works which were written by white people, especially white men than women. But after this Renaissance, or after this Harlem Renaissance, with the beginning of Harlem Renaissance, African American writers started to write about their life and their culture. So they wanted to voice the problems they suffered as slaves. They attacked the stereotypes of black Americans and wrote about what it felt to be left out of the mainstream America. Around the turn of 20th century, many African Americans were living in the southern parts of United States. That is way before the Civil War of 1860s. During those times, the Africans, they were called the Negroes or the Niggers, they were kept as slaves in inhuman conditions by the white people. Especially the southern part of America, they favored slavery. They were the northern part of America, on the other hand, wanted to abolish slavery. That's what you have in when you have studied of Abraham Lincoln. He wanted to abolish slavery because and he was totally against slavery. The northern states of America was totally against slavery. They lived in inhuman conditions in the southern parts of America. But after the Civil War, these slaves were freed and most of them stayed in rural South. They did not move to other parts. They decided to stay there itself. But what happened was the attitude of these people, that's the Southern Americans, were still, they did not like them. They considered them as slaves. They did not want to mingle with them. And therefore, since the rule was passed, or since slavery was abolished, they could not keep them as slaves. So what they did, the Southern parts passed a series of laws called Jim Crow laws. Now, this was a biased law, a prejudiced and a very biased law. And they say this law stated that the blacks could not eat at the same restaurant. They could not settle in the same place where the whites are staying. They couldn't drink from the same tap or the fountain. They couldn't attend the same pubs. They couldn't eat or dine at the same inns. They cannot go to the same theater, and so on and so forth. They were like treated, still they were treated like slaves, just like the attitudes that our Indians had towards the Dalits or the untouchables in the past. So the white Americans, even after Civil War, treated the blacks like slaves, the Southern Americans, the white Americans, that is. So though slavery was abolished, the attitude of the whites towards the black continued in the form of racism. So if the parent was slavery, if you personify it, you could have slavery as the parent and racism is the child of slavery, and it is much more monstrous and deadlier than its parent, slavery. Okay, so that was the, so after the abolition of slavery, slavery gave way to another thing called racism. Slavery was abolished and therefore the attitude of the people, they showed it in the form of racism, which was deadlier than slavery. So because of this Jim Crow laws in South America, what these blacks did, they had to move to safer places in America. So northern parts they favored, or they treated them better. They considered them as equals. It was more favorable to them. The conditions were more favorable to the black Americans or the African Americans, and therefore they decided to move to the northeastern parts of the country, especially to other parts of the country, particularly to the northeastern parts of the country where there were no such laws. So a large crowd of black Americans moved and settled in the north in the early 1920s. And this large movement of the people moving to other cities from the southern parts of America led to what we call Harlem Renaissance. Especially it was named Harlem Renaissance because these people, they settled in the city of Harlem, that is a place in North Manhattan, in northern part of northeastern part of America, in the north of Manhattan. The place is called Harlem. So from there, these people started writing, the African Americans, they started writing about their pain and their problems, and a new kind of literature was born. So there you have the Harlem Renaissance. Now Harlem Renaissance starts when the African American writers start to write about the slavery and their hardships in writing. Another thing that influenced the Harlem Renaissance was the jazz music. They were influenced by the European music, that they merged African and European music to form a new type of music. This became known as jazz music. So in 1920s, America came up with a new form of music called the jazz music. It had rhythm, it had poetry. Besides, all were interested in this, and this freed the limitation set forward by race. It was not like it was, this jazz music is meant for the blacks only or the Africans only. It was like enjoyed by everyone. It was a merge of both European music and African music. So it was enjoyed by almost everyone. It freed them from this limitation of race. This allowed many African Americans to search for new ways to express the plight of their people, and this is what is known as Harlem Renaissance. So all these had an impact on African American poetry also. Okay, jazz music is actually rhythm and poetry, so it also led to a lot of literature, different genres. Harlem Renaissance, so you can see that in this impact in the African American poetry. The greatest poets, important poets associated with, some important poets associated with Harlem Renaissance are Zora Neale, Langston Hughes, especially Langston Hughes. We are not going deep into others. We'll just stick to Langston Hughes at present. Now all of them talked about the condition of the black people in America. Langston Hughes was one of the prominent writers of Harlem Renaissance. Mother to Son by Langston Hughes is a 20-line poem that is contained within a stanza of text. Hughes composed the text in free verse. What is free verse? Free verse means that there is no pattern of rhyme or rhythm. But they are indeed lyrical. If you look at the poem, there is no pattern or rhythm, but they are lyrical in nature. This can be seen in the thoughtful selection of his words. They reflect the specific dialect, you know, the Negro language, okay, used in the poem. You have seen that, you have seen some of you, like some of the music, right? Jazz, like the rap music and all, you know how a black person, African would sing, or they would pronounce words. They're quite different from the European pronunciation. So it was mostly they used nigger language or Negro language. And you will also find examples of half rhyme throughout the text. Now you have studied what half rhyme is, so you will find half rhyme here in Langston Hughes' Mother to Son. In a free verse, lines are unrhymed and there are no consistent metrical patterns. But that doesn't mean that it is entirely without structure. It has a structure, of course. Mother to Son has a structure, but then here in mostly in free verse, there is no. It is free from all metrical patterns. Now, in the first section of the poem, Hughes begins with a speaker addressing her son. The first words, "Well, son, I'll tell you," sets up the conversation, a type of conversation that a mother is going to speak to her son. So it's like an informal one. It's not like very formal one. A mother is going to give advice to her son who's growing up. So it sets up the conversation as informal, but that does not mean that it is something very silly. Her message is something very, very important. It has impact, deep impact. She clearly has something and she needs to tell him, and it isn't going to be easy. So it's about growing up, one thing. Another thing is it's about growing up. The son is growing up. He needs to know of his limitations. He needs to know of how he should grow up, the pain, life that is in going to be, or that he's going to confront, things that he would be confronting, especially he's an African American. So she is hinting at several things to be more careful in the ways he should be carrying himself, the ways he should, people whom he should look out for, where he should be more careful, several setbacks that he's going to face. Even if he's talented, even if he's skilled, there are people who would be biased. Especially, so she's hinting at racism. At the same time, she's also hinting at the so-called life, what life really is. Growing up, life is not a bed of roses. You will come across several things. It's dark, it's dreary, it's like a staircase. Okay, there's a big metaphor, very important metaphor, and that is the metaphor is that of the staircase. So the main thing that the mother wants to tell her son is that life for her, she gives her own story, her story to her son. She says that life hasn't been a crystal staircase. Life hasn't been no crystal staircase. See the nigger language. So no crystal stairs. So here she is contrasting her own life against the one that is easy to progress and go up. In her case, moving forward represents a staircase with tacks and splinters protruding from the wood, all broken, and you should be very careful when you climb the stairs. You would fall down any moment. It's not like the crystal stairs that the Europeans are used to climbing up. For them it's easy. For the rich people, for the rich class and the whites, it's easy to climb because life is prejudiced, life is biased. So here she's hinting at racism also. Here she's a poor woman, she's a black woman, she's a black mother,
She has had a lot of problems that she had to face in life. So staircase is a metaphor for life. And here the staircase is not a simple one, it's not a safe one. It is a broken one where you can fall anytime. It's had tacks in it and splinters and boards torn up, places with no carpets, etc. If you look at those lines. So the steps were falling apart and there were spots no longer covered by carpet. The wood is also torn up in places, entire boards missing. It is dangerous to live her life, and more often than no, each line presents, or the steps, the image that it gives presents something new to fear. So the steps were falling apart and there were spots which were no longer covered by the carpet. The wood is also torn up in places. The entire boards are missing. Some places there are no boards at all. So it is dangerous to live her life. And if you look at the word no at each line, it and also the step images which are broken, which are missing, where the carpets are not covered, all that presents something that we have to fear about, that life, it is not easy. You could fall any time. So the fact that boards are missing from the staircase speaks of the lack of support she received, or to the missing links in her own understanding of what she should do next. Now, certain times in life when you are faced with certain problems, you do not know what to do next. You are perplexed, you look stunned, and you are shaken. So then what do you do normally at that time? We stay calm and we pray to God, right? So here she gives her son certain advices. Okay, the last lines, if you look at the last lines of the poem, they add to the already painful and at times scary staircase that has already been described. Of the boards that do remain on the stairs and the landings, she will come to all these that she will come to in the next few lines. Some of these stairs, they don't have a carpet. Again, she is describing the poor conditions that she has to deal with and what a struggle it had been for her to live, especially she being a poor African American. So the fact that the boards are missing from the staircase speaks of the lack of support she received, or to the missing links in her own response, in her own understanding of what she should do next. Certain times in life we are shaken, we face a lot of troubles, and during this time we do not know what to do next. We stand all perplexed. All we can do is stay calm for some time and pray, and that is the most important step. Now, in the poem when she describes of the carpet, those places where there are no carpet, she is describing the poor condition she has to deal with and all the struggle that she has been going through and still will have to go through for till the end of her life. Now, as we move on with the poem, so despite all the things mentioned, the speaker, that is the poet's mother, still moves forward. She wants to make sure that above all else, this is the lesson her son should learn all the time. And what's the lesson? What does she want her son to make sure to keep on climbing? To persevere, to move on. She has been climbing up the metaphorical stairs of her life. To describe the different periods of her life, she inserts landings into the staircase. So to tell you of the difficulties that she had to face, she tells us about various landings that she had to, she inserts various landings into the staircase. And certain times where it's like a big long staircase which is curved and curved. Okay, when you reach one set of stairs, when you climb one set of stairs, there's a landing and you have to you can pause for some time to climb the next set of stairs. So each landing, she uses each landing to describe the difficulties that she has had to face in her life. So whenever she reached the landing, she went ahead and turned the corner. She says that the speaker was not afraid of what might be on the other side. It's all dark. She doesn't know what is coming. So it's like future. You don't know what your future is. So your life is like a metaphor. And the landings, when you come to the landings, you are ready to take the next set of stairs. You do not know what is coming in front of you, what you are going to face. Okay, so here the speaker is not afraid. She's ready to climb, and she is not going to quit. Whenever she reached the landings, she went ahead and turned the corner. Okay, so there is another character trait here, which she is hoping to pass on to her son. Even though she knows how bad things can be, poor people, the lives of the poor are not easy. It is difficult. So she knows that it is difficult, but even then she's unafraid. She's not ready to quit, and she is strong enough to face them. Not only are these places that she's forced to go dark, that is her future that she's moving towards. She doesn't know where she would land, her life, what turn it would take, what things she would have to encounter. It is dark, but these are places where she has never been before, no traces of light at all. She says, or she moves on these places, these corridors of life. She's brave, bold. She faces them boldly, even though every step she takes is not a safe one. She is determined to fight. So the speaker addresses the son by saying that he should not sit down or fall down when problems come to his life. The problems that come to our lives are like the hidden ones. We do not know what we will encounter next. It's like a staircase. We climb the stairs. When we reach the next landing and when we are about to start the next set of stairs, maybe the boards would be broken. Maybe the place where we step is cracked and we would fall. We do not know of what is in store for us. Unprecedented things could happen, but shouldn't pull us down. That shouldn't make us upset. We shouldn't quit. We should be bold enough to face. So that's the thing that the speaker wants to pass to her son. She says, or she tells him, that he should not sit down or fall down just because his staircase is hard to climb. In mother's eyes, the son should never give up. Instead, he should see her as an example, because it was not easy for her. She never gave up. With the extended metaphor of a staircase as a symbol of the steps one has to take in life, one can infer that as long as a person is living, there will be more and more steps to climb. That's the main message of the poem. Life is hard. Life is difficult. It is like a never-ending staircase. We are climbing each stairs. Sometimes we fall. Sometimes we trip. Sometimes the boards are broken. Sometimes it's not an easy one. Only very few people can climb those crystal, stairs. The rich ones. Even all the religious books tell, what do they tell you? The path to glory, the path to heaven, is not an easy one. It's not the highway. The road to heaven is filled with
thorns and full of difficulties. So we mustn't give up. We must take this poem as it's not just to Langston Hughes. It's not just the poem Mother to Son. The speaker is not just addressing the son, but perhaps the speaker is addressing all of us and telling us that we should be bold and we should climb our stairs. Even though it is difficult to climb, we should be able to climb them without quitting. We should be bold enough. So with this extended metaphor of staircase, a symbol of steps one takes in life, one can infer that as long as a person is living, there will be more and more steps to climb. Okay, thus mother is symbolically climbing the stairway to heaven, and the path to heaven is not always an easy journey. The mother wants the son to know that heaven is worth by taking life one step at a time. Even if the stairs are full of tacks and splinters, full of difficulties, this eventually, when we face the hardships of life, we will see heaven. We will see the gift that God has in store for us. Okay, and so this poem is a very motivating kind of poem. It is a motivational poem. Hughes illustrates the sense of identity in the speaker by using the vernacular language. He uses the nigger language. If you look at those, the poem, you will see how it's like the African American talking to her son. It's not a formal one, it's an informal conversation. He uses the language that mother would act or speak to the son. She uses the word boy to call his attention and make sure he's still listening to her. Okay. I hope you have understood the poem. If you have any doubts, we shall take it up during our interactions. So thank you and keep safe.